Very good morning to all of you. Today the topic for discussion is appeal from section 372 to 394 of the code.
Section 372 to section 394 of the code deals with the chapter of appeal. Now, appeal can be said to be as a transference of a case from an inferior to a higher court or tribunal in the hope of reversing or modifying the decision of the former. Means approaching the superior court from the decision of the lower court or inferior court for modifying or reversing the decision or order which is being passed by the inferior court. Right of appeal is not a natural and inherent right. It is a right which is being created by a statute. It must be expressly given by a statute. An appeal is removal of a cause from an inferior court to superior court for purpose of testing the soundness of decision of court. Right of appeal is not a mere matter of procedure, but it is a substantive right. It is a corrective right and an integral part of natural justice, but this is not an absolute right. An appeal is only a continuation of trial, and consequently the appellate court has powers to do only what the lower court could do and should have done. An appeal lies on fact as well as law, and where an appeal lies and no appeal is brought before the court, revision is not entertainable. Section 372 provide that no appeal shall lie from any judgment or order of a criminal court except as provided for by this court or by any other law for the time being in force. And the proviso to section 372 provides, and which was added by the Amendment Act 5 of 2009, and which provides that the victim shall have a right to prefer an appeal against any order passed by the court acquitting the accused or convicting him for a lesser offence or imposing inadequate compensation, and such appeal shall lie to the court which an appeal ordinarily lies against the order of conviction of such court. Section 372 makes it very clear that an appeal is a continuation of the trial of the lower court, but an appeal is a creation of statute, and there is no inherent right of appeal unless and until it is being provided either by the court or by any other law for the time being in force. The proviso to section 372 gives a limited right to the victim to file an appeal in the superior court against any order of a criminal court acquitting the accused or convicting him for a lesser offence or the imposition of inadequate compensation. Now, who is a victim for the purpose of section 372? Now, section 2 clause WA of the code defines a victim, and it states a victim means a person who has suffered any loss or injury caused by reason of the act or omission for which the accused person has been charged, and the expression victim includes his or her guardian or legal heir. A question came before the court as the definition of victim includes her guardian or legal heirs, so whether anybody other than the real victim can prefer an appeal. And the same was being answered by the Madras High Court in S. Ganpati versus N. Senthival, and which followed the ratio of the Supreme Court in the case of Satyapal Singh versus State of MP and held as follows. A victim of the crime who is prosecuted and accused by way of a private complaint has a statutory right of appeal within the limits prescribed under section 372 of CRPC. Now, if a complainant in a private complaint who is not a victim has a remedy and can file an appeal in the event of acquittal of the accused after obtaining leave to appeal under section 378 subsection 4 of CRPC. And in a private complaint, even if the victim is not a complainant, he has a right to appeal under the proviso to section 372 of CRPC, but he has to seek leave from the court. Section 372 of the code has conferred upon a victim a substantive and independent right to maintain an appeal against acquittal. In the case of Rupendra Singh versus State of Tripura, the court held that merely because leave to appeal was not granted to the state to prefer an appeal against acquittal, the appeal preferred by the victim informant ought not to have been rejected by the High Court summarily. Section 374 provides for appeal against the judgment to the Supreme Court, to the High Court, and to the Court of Session. Now, subsection 1 of section 374 provides that in an appeal from conviction, if any person who is convicted on a trial held by the High Court in its extraordinary original criminal jurisdiction, then he may appeal to the Supreme Court. Subsection 2 provides that any person convicted on a trial held by a session judge or an additional session judge or a trial held by any court in which a sentence of imprisonment for more than 7 years has been passed against him or against any other person convicted at the same trial may appeal to the High Court. Subsection 3. Save as otherwise provided in subsection 2, any person convicted on a trial held by a metropolitan magistrate or an assistant session judge or a magistrate of the first class or second class or sentenced under section 325 or in respect of whom an order has been made or a sentence has been passed under section 360 by any magistrate may appeal to the court of session. Section 373 of CRPC provides for appeal against orders regarding securities. It provides that any person who has been ordered under section 117 to give security for keeping the peace or for good behavior or is aggrieved by any order refusing to accept or rejecting a surety under section 121 may appeal to the court of session. No appeal in certain cases when the accused pleads guilty. Section 375 of the code provides that notwithstanding anything contained in section 374, where an accused person has pleaded guilty or has been convicted on such plea, there shall be no appeal if the conviction is by a high court or if the conviction is by a court of session, metropolitan magistrate or magistrate of the first class or second class, except as to the extent or legality of the sentence. Under section 375, no appeal is provided in certain cases when accused pleads guilty. Now, as you have already seen in that trial before court of session as well as in a trial of warrant case by magistrate, that at a particular stage after the framing of charge, the accused may plead guilty for the charges which is being framed against the accused. Now, if the accused pleads guilty for those charges, then by virtue of section 375, no appeal can be preferred against such conviction. It puts a bar to bring an appeal in cases when he pleads guilty and is convicted on such plea is provided under section 375, wherein 375 ACRPC provides that there shall be no appeal if the conviction is by a high court. 375B provides and gives exception to bring an appeal, but only as to the extent of legality of the sentence. If the conviction on plea of guilty is ordered by the court of session or the magistrate of the first class or second class. In re U.R. Ramaswamy, it was held that when the facts alleged by the prosecution do not amount to an offence, the plea of guilty cannot stand in the way of the accused being acquitted. In such a case, the bar under section 375 of the Code of CRPC for an appeal will not apply. Section 376 provides for no appeal in petty cases. It provides that appeal cannot be made by a convicted person in certain cases and which are provided under section 376 of the code. Section 376 reads as, notwithstanding anything contained in section 374, there shall be no appeal by a convicted person in any of the following cases, namely, A. Where a high court passes only a sentence of imprisonment for a term not exceeding 6 months or of fine not exceeding 1000 rupees or of both such imprisonment and fine. B. Where a court of session or a metropolitan magistrate passes only a sentence of imprisonment for a term not exceeding 3 months or of fine not exceeding 200 rupees or of both such imprisonment and fine. C. Where a magistrate of the first class passes only a sentence of fine not exceeding 100 rupees. Or D. Where in a case tried summarily, a magistrate empowered to act under section 260 passes only a sentence of fine not exceeding 200 rupees. Now, in all these cases, a convicted person is not permitted to appeal. But provided that an appeal may be brought against any such sentence if any other punishment is combined with it, but such sentence shall not be appealable on the mere ground. First, that the person convicted is ordered to furnish security to keep the peace. Or second, that a direction for imprisonment in default of payment of fine is included in the sentence. Or third, that more than one sentence of fine is passed in the case and if the total amount of the fine imposed does not exceed the amount herein before specified in respect of the case. Section 377 of the code provides appeal by state government against sentence on the ground of its inadequacy. It reads as, subsection 1, save as otherwise provided in subsection 2, the state government may, in any case of conviction on a trial held by any court other than a high court, direct the public prosecutor to present an appeal against the sentence on the ground of its inadequacy. A. To the court of session if the sentence is passed by the magistrate. B. To the high court if the sentence is passed by any other court. Subsection 2. Now, if such a conviction is in a case in which the offence has been investigated by the Delhi Police Establishment constituted under the Delhi Police Establishment Act 1946 or by any other agency empowered to make investigation into an offence under Central Act other than this code, the central government may also direct the public prosecutor to present an appeal against the sentence on the ground of its inadequacy. A. To the court of session if the sentence is passed by the magistrate. B. To the high court if the sentence is passed by the any other court. Now, subsection 3. When an appeal has been filed against the sentence on the ground of its inadequacy, the court of session, as the case may be, the high court shall not enhance the sentence except after giving to the accused a reasonable opportunity of showing cause against such enhancement, and while showing cause, the accused may plead for his acquittal or for the reduction of the sentence. Subsection 4 is being added by the Criminal Law Amendment Act of 2018, which provides that with respect to an appeal which has been filed against a sentence passed under Section 376, 376A, 376AB, 376B, Section 376C, 376D, and so of the Indian Penal Code, appeal shall be disposed of within a period of 6 months from the date of filing of such appeal. Section 377 provides that the state government can file an appeal to the High Court and to the Court of Session against the sentence on the ground of its inadequacy. Now, under subsection 1 of Section 377, the state government has a right to appeal against the inadequacy of sentence in all cases other than those referred in subsection 2 of that section, and this is made clear that under Section 377, subsection 1, by its opening clause, save as otherwise provided in subsection 2. And subsection 2 of section 377, on the other hand, confers a right of appeal on the central government against a sentence on the ground of its inadequacy in two cases. First, those cases were investigated by the Delhi Police Establishment, constituted under the Delhi Police Establishment Act. And second, those cases which are investigated by any other agency empowered to make investigation under any central act, not being the Code of Criminal Procedure. And subsection 3 further stipulates that in an appeal for enhancement of sentence, the accused may plead for his acquittal. Section 378 of the code provides for appeal in cases of acquittal. Kindly go through the provision, and after going through the provision, you'll find that the first four subsections of section 378, in an appeal against an order of acquittal, it can be preferred by the government, or in a case instituted or a complaint by the government as well as by the complainant, and this right of appeal can be exercised only after obtaining the leave of the High Court. And third, and when the order of acquittal is passed by any magistrate or by any session judge, and whether the offence of which the accused is acquitted is a major or minor offence, the appeal in every case of such acquittal could be made only to the High Court. Subsection 6 provides that an appeal by the state under subsection 1 or subsection 2 is barred in a case where the private complainant has failed to obtain special leave to appeal under subsection 4. And subsection 5 provides with respect to the limitation period, which states that no application under subsection 4 for the grant of special leave to appeal from an order of acquittal shall be entertained by the High Court after the expiry of 6 months where the complainant is a public servant, and 60 days in every other case, computed from the date of that order of acquittal. In V. Sejappa versus State, the Supreme Court, after referring to its earlier decision, formulated certain principles to be followed by the appellate court while hearing an appeal against acquittal. The apex court held as under, in quotes, if the evaluation of the evidence and the findings recorded by the trial court do not suffer from any illegality or perversity, and the grounds on which the trial court has based its conclusions are reasonable and plausible, the High Court should not disturb the order of acquittal if another view is possible, merely because the appellate court on re-appreciation and re-evaluation of the evidence is inclined to take a different view. Interference with the judgment of the acquittal is not justified if the view taken by the trial court is a possible view. unquote. Now, while dealing with the appeals against acquittal, the appellate court must bear in mind the following points. First, that there is a presumption of innocence in favor of an accused person, and such presumption is strengthened by the order of acquittal passed in favor by the trial court. Second, the accused person is entitled to benefit of reasonable doubt when it deals with the merit of the appeal against acquittal. Third, though the powers of the appellate court in considering the appeals against acquittal are as extensive as its powers in appeal against convictions, but the appellate court is generally loath in disturbing the findings of fact recorded by the trial court. It is so because the trial court had an advantage of seeing the demeanor of the witnesses. If the trial court takes a reasonable view of the facts of the case, interference by the appellate court with the judgment of acquittal is not justified. Unless the conclusions reached by the trial court are palpably wrong or based on erroneous view of the law, or if such conclusions are allowed to stand, they are likely to result in grave injustice. The reluctance on the part of the appellate court in interfering with such conclusions is fully justified. And lastly, merely because the appellate court on reappreciation and reevaluation of the evidence is inclined to take a different view, interference with the judgment of acquittal is not justified if the view taken by the trial court is a possible view. The evenly balanced views of the evidence must not result in the interference by the appellate court in the judgment of the trial court. From the scheme of the provisions of section 378, it is clear that the two streams of appeals against acquittals are provided. The first stream of appeal is against the order of acquittals to be preferred by the state government or central government, and the same would be under subsection 1 and subsection 2 of section 378. And before such an appeal is entertained, a leave of the High Court requires to be taken, as provided for under subsection 3 of section 378. The other stream of appeal is against the order of acquittals in the complaint case, wherein by virtue of section 378 subsection 4, the complainant has to seek special leave to appeal from the High Court under subsection 5. Further, the application for grant of special leave to appeal must be filed if the complainant is a public servant within 6 months from the date of order of acquittal, and in all other cases within 60 days from the date of order of the acquittal. For the first stream of appeal under subsection 1 and subsection 2, read with subsection 3 of section 378, no period of limitation is provided under section 378 or any other section of CRPC. Hence, in these cases, the period of limitation for filing the appeal under section 378 subsection 1 and 378 subsection 2 is 90 days from the date of order of appealed from, as provided in Article 114, Clause A of the Limitation Act. Though this was in reference to the section 417 of the old code of 1898, but the Supreme Court in State Delhi Administration versus Dharampal Singh held that this equally applies to section 378 subsection 1 and subsection 2 of the code. Whenever a petition seeking leave to appeal is being made to the court, the same cannot be dismissed casually or summarily. There is a statutory requirement that the court, while refusing the leave to appeal, must assign reasons for refusing the same. Section 379 provides where the High Court has on appeal reversed an order of acquittal of an accused person and convicted him and sentenced him to death or an imprisonment for life or to imprisonment for a term of 10 years or more, then he may appeal to the Supreme Court. In Satvir Singh versus State of Delhi, the Supreme Court held that the High Court has full power to review, reappreciate and reconsider the evidence upon which the order of acquittal is founded, but it should not disturb the finding of the trial court if two reasonable conclusions are possible on the basis of evidence on record. Section 380 of the Code provides special right of appeal in certain cases. It provides that notwithstanding anything contained in this chapter, where more persons than one are convicted in one trial and an appealable judgment or order has been passed in respect of any of such persons, all or any of the persons convicted at such trial shall have a right of appeal. In case of Singhala Singh versus State of Haryana, the High Court convicted both father and son under section 304, read with section 34 IPC. Son filed the criminal appeal before the Supreme Court and the father preferred a special leave petition before the Supreme Court. So in this case, it was held that in view of the provisions of section 380 of the code, where the order and the judgment passed by the High Court was appealable and the co-accused son had filed an appeal, the father could also have exercised his right of appeal instead of filing a special leave petition before the Supreme Court. Section 382 lays down the procedure and practice of filing an appeal and lays down that it has to be filed in the form of a petition in writing presented by the appellant or his pleader. And every such petition shall, unless the court otherwise direct, be accompanied by a copy of the judgment or order appealed against. Section 383 provides if the appellant is in jail, he may present his petition of appeal and the copies accompanied the same to the officer in charge of the jail, who shall thereupon forward such petition and copies to the proper appellate court. Section 384 of the code provides for summary dismissal of appeal. Now, section 384 empowers the appellate court to dismiss the appeal summarily if it considered that there is no sufficient ground for interference. Perusal of section 384 of the code provides that if after examining the petition of appeal and the copy of the judgment received under section 382 or section 383, the appellate court finds that there is no sufficient ground for interfering, it can dismiss the appeal summarily. However, if an appeal is presented under section 382 of the code, it cannot be dismissed unless the appellant or his advocate is given reasonable opportunity of hearing. Appeal presented under section 383 also cannot be dismissed without such opportunity unless the appellate court considers that appeal is frivolous or that production of the accused in custody before the court would involve such inconvenience as would be disproportionate in the circumstances of the case. An appeal presented under 383 cannot be dismissed summarily until period allowing for preferring such appeal has expired. Subsection 2 thereof provides that before summary dismissal of appeal, the court can file records from the trial court, and subsection 3 is on requirement of recording reasons in support of such dismissal. The appellate power under section 384 to dismiss an appeal must be exercised sparingly and with great circumspection. Serious matters such as conviction for murder and a sentence of life imprisonment warrant admission of such appeal. Appeals must be summarily dismissed only in cases when there is no arguable question of fact or law and not otherwise. Section 385, procedure for hearing appeals not dismissed summarily. Now, if the appellate court does not dismiss the appeal summarily, it shall cause notice of the time and place at which such appeal will be heard be given to the appellant or his pleader, to such officer as the state government may appoint in this behalf, if the appeal is from a judgment of conviction in a case instituted upon complaint to the complainant, if the appeal is under section 377 or section 378 to the accused, and shall also furnish such officer or complainant and the accused with a copy of the grounds of appeal. Subsection 2, the appellate court shall then send for the record of the case if such record is not readily available in the court and hear the parties. Provided that if the appeal is only to the extent of the legality of the sentence, the court may dispose of the appeal without sending for the record. Subsection 3, where the only ground for appeal from a conviction is alleged severity of the sentence, the appellate shall not accept with the leave of the court, urge or be heard in support of any ground. In Shyamdev Pandey versus State of Bihar, the Supreme Court held that if an appeal was not dismissed summarily and admitted to hearing, the same thereafter had to be disposed of on merits after perusal of the court record. The appeal could not be dismissed for non-prosecution, and even in the event of default, the appellate court was to consider the case on merits after perusing the evidence on record and then pass a judgment. In the case of K. Anbar Zagan versus State of Karnataka, a three-judge bench addressing the manner of exercising of jurisdiction by the appellate court while deciding an appeal has ruled that, in quotes, the appellate court has a duty to make a complete and comprehensive appreciation of all vital features of the case. The evidence brought on record in entirety has to be scrutinized with care and caution. It is the duty of the judge to see that justice is appropriately administered, for what that is the paramount consideration of a judge. The said responsibility cannot be abdicated or abandoned or ostracized even remotely solely because there might not have been proper assistance by the counsel appearing for the parties. The appellate court is required to weigh the materials, ascribe concrete reasons, and filament of reasoning must logically flow from the requisite analysis of the material on record. The approach cannot be cryptic, it cannot be perverse,
The duty of a judge is to consider the evidence objectively and dispassionately. The reasoning in appeal are to be well deliberated. They are to be resolutely expressed. An objective judgment of the evidence reflects the greatness of mind. Sans passion and sans prejudice. The reflective attitude of the judge must be demonstrable from the judgment itself. A judge must avoid all kind of weakness and vacillation. That is the sole test, that is the litmus test. Under section 386 clause A and clause B sub clause 1, the power to direct retrial has been conferred upon the appellate court when it deals either with an appeal against the judgment of conviction or an appeal against acquittal. Now there is a difference between the powers of the appellate court under clause A and clause B. Under clause B, the court is required to touch the finding and sentence, but under clause A, the court may reverse the order of acquittal, direct that further inquiry be made, or the accused may be retried or may find him guilty and pass sentence on him according to law. In the case of Isaac versus Ronald Cherian, the court held that normally retrial should not be ordered when there is some infirmity rendering the trial defective. A retrial may be ordered when the original trial has not been satisfactory for particular reasons like non-framing of appropriate charge, evidence wrongly rejected which could have been admitted, or evidence admitted which could have been rejected, etc. Retrial cannot be ordered when there is a mere irregularity or where it does not cause any prejudice. The appellate court may not direct retrial. The power to order retrial should be exercised only in exceptional cases. In Banwari versus State, it's being held that the High Court has full power while hearing an appeal against an order of acquittal to reappreciate the evidence and to come to a conclusion whether the order of acquittal passed by the session judge was per se bad or not. After perusing such record and the hearing the appellant or his pleader if he appears and the public prosecutor if he appears, and then in case of an appeal under section 377, that is appeal by the state government against sentence, or section 378, which are appeal in cases of acquittal, the accused if he appears, the appellate court may, if it considers that there is no sufficient ground for interfering, dismiss the appeal, or if the appellate court does not dismiss the appeal, may in the case of an appeal from an order of acquittal, it may reverse the order and direct that further inquiry be carried out or that the accused be retried or committed for trial. Even in the case of an appeal from an order of acquittal, in the appellate court is competent to find him guilty and pass sentence on him according to law. The proviso to this section prescribes that the sentence shall not be enhanced unless the accused has an opportunity of showing cause against such a proposal, thereby mandating that an accused must be present and must be heard if an order of acquittal is to be upturned and reversed. And in the case of an appeal from a conviction or an enhancement of sentence, section 380 CRPC lays down that after perusing such record and hearing the appellant or his pleader and the public prosecutor, the appellate court may in an appeal from conviction or enhancement of sentence reverse the finding and sentence and acquit or discharge the accused or order him to be retried by a court of competent jurisdiction or alter the finding maintaining the sentence. But in the case of appeal from conviction, the appellate court may also, with or without altering the finding, alter the nature or the extent or the nature and extent of the sentence, but not as to enhance the same. As in an appeal from an enhancement of sentence, the appellate court may enhance the same, provided that the sentence shall not be enhanced unless the accused had an opportunity of showing cause against such enhancement. Appellate court may in any other appeal from any other order may alter or reverse such order and may also make any amendment or any consequential or incidental order that may be just or proper. The word reverse means to make void, to set aside or annul or turn into something completely opposite in character. It means a complete change in substance and form. The term conveys a sense of obliteration or effacement which happens when conviction is set aside. The word finding relates to the result of a judicial examination or inquiry, especially into some matter of fact. The expressions reverse the finding and sentence occurring in clause B of section 386 means reversing of the finding upon which the conviction is based. The word reverse the finding and sentence mean total obliteration of the finding of conviction and sentence recorded, and the term reversal connotes a complete annulment of a finding of guilt by the appellate court so as to convert a decision that a man is guilty into a finding that he is innocent. In the case of State of HP versus Nirmala Devi, it has been held that reversal of sentence or order implies the obliteration, whereas alteration implies only modification and not obliteration.
Supreme Court in the case of Ram Naresh Yadav versus State of Bihar considered the consequence of the non-appearance of appellant or his counsel and observed in quotes, it is no doubt true that if the counsel do not appear when criminal appeals are called out, it would hamper the working of the court and create a serious problem for the court. And if this happens often, the working of the court would become well high impossible. So we are fully conscious of this dimension of the matter, but in criminal matters, the convict must be heard before the matters are decided on merits. The court can dismiss the appeal for non-prosecution and enforce discipline or prefer the matter to the bar counsel with this end in view. But the matter can be disposed of on merits only after hearing the appellant or his counsel. The court might as well appoint a counsel at state cost to argue on behalf of the appellants. Unquote.
So, a three-judge bench in Bani Singh versus State of UP observed, in quotes, the law does not enjoin that the court shall adjourn the case if both the appellant and his lawyer are absent. It can dispose of the appeal after perusing the record and the judgment of the trial court. If the accused is in jail and cannot on his own come to court, it would be advisable to hear the case and fix another date to facilitate the appearance of the accused or appellant if his lawyer is not present. If the lawyer is absent and the court deems it appropriate to appoint a lawyer at state expense to assist it, there is nothing in the law to preclude it from doing so. Unquote.
Section 387 provides for judgment of subordinate appellate court, which states that the rules contained in Chapter 27 as to the judgment of a criminal court of original jurisdiction shall apply so far as may be practicable to the judgment in appeal of a court of session or a chief judicial magistrate. And the accused shall not be brought up or required to attend or hear the judgment delivered unless the appellate court so directs.
Section 388 of the court provides, whenever a case is decided on appeal by the High Court under this chapter, it shall certify its judgment or order of the High Court by which the finding, sentence or order appeal against was recorded or passed, and if such order is that of a judicial magistrate other than the chief judicial magistrate, the High Court's judgment or order shall be sent through the chief judicial magistrate, and if such court is that of an executive magistrate, the High Court's judgment or order shall be sent through the district magistrate.
Subsection 2 further provides that the court to which the High Court certifies its judgment or order shall thereupon make such orders as are confirmable to the judgment or order of the High Court, and if necessary, the record shall be amended in accordance therewith.
Section 389, suspension of sentence pending the appeal, release of appellant on bail. Subsection 1, pending any appeal by a convicted person, the appellate court may, for reasons to be recorded by it in writing, order that the execution of the sentence or order appeal against be suspended, and also, if he is in confinement, that he be released on bail or on his own bond, provided that the appellate court shall, before releasing on bail or on his own bond, a convicted person who is convicted of an offence punishable with death or imprisonment for life or imprisonment for a term not less than 10 years shall give opportunity to the public prosecutor for showing cause in writing against such release. Provided further that in cases where a convicted person is released on bail, it shall be open to the public prosecutor to file an application for the cancellation of the bail. Subsection 2. The power conferred by this section on an appellate court may be exercised also by the High Court in the case of an appeal by a convicted person to a court subordinate thereto. Subsection 3. Where the convicted person satisfies the court by which he is convicted that he intends to present an appeal, the court shall, where such person being on bail is sentenced to imprisonment for a term not exceeding 3 years, or where the offence of which such person has been convicted is a bailable one and he is on bail, order that the convicted person be released on bail unless there are special reasons for refusing bail for such period as will afford sufficient time to present the appeal and obtain the orders of the appellate court under subsection 1, and the sentence of imprisonment shall, so long as he is so released on bail, be deemed to be suspended. Subsection 4. When the appellant is ultimately sentenced to imprisonment for a term or to imprisonment for life, the time during which he is so released shall be excluded in computing the term for which he is so sentenced.
under subsection 1 and subsection 2 of section 389, the appellate court may order for suspension of the execution of the sentence or the order appeal against. Here, suspension means to take or withdraw sentence for the time being. Subsection 1 and 2 also deals with a situation where a convicted person can get a bail from the appellate court after filing the criminal appeal. Section 3 of section 389 deals with a situation where the trial court itself can grant a bail to the convicted accused, enabling him to prefer an appeal. The appellate court can alone exercise the powers conferred by subsection 1 of this section, but where no appeal is preferred, the powers cannot be exercised, because the subsection says pending any appeal by a convicted person, when there is no appeal pending, so court cannot exercise the power conferred by the section. In the case of Navjot Singh Sidhu versus State of Punjab, it was held that in a case of request for suspension of conviction, the appellant has to draw specific attention of the court to the consequences that follow his conviction. The court has to exercise this power under subsection 1 of section 389 in rare cases, depending on special facts of the case. The appellant in the present case was a sitting member of parliament, and he was convicted of an offence before when he entered into politics. After his conviction, he resigned from membership of parliament and did not take the benefit of by clinging to his office by merely filing an appeal. It was held in this case that the evidence touching upon culpability of appellant prima facie appeared to be in his favor. Appellant, by resigning from membership of parliament, has chosen a moral path and has set high standards in public life. Therefore, his conviction was liable to be suspended, as injury that would he suffer if conviction is not suspended would be irreparable. The stay of conviction can be granted under section 389 in exceptional cases and rare circumstances, especially where non-grant of stay would lead to injustice and irreversible consequences. Those specific circumstances are to be brought to the notice of the appellant court by the convict seeking stay. Otherwise, stay cannot be granted. Now, where the conviction itself is stayed, the effect is that the conviction will not be operative from the date of stay. An order of stay, of course, does not render the conviction non-existent, but only makes it non-operative. Under section 389, the appellate court cannot suspend the sentence, but can only suspend the execution thereof. In the case of Mayuram Subramaniam Srinivasan versus CBI, the court held that section 383 subsection 3 is applicable only in the following conditions. First, that the court must be the convicting court. Second, the accused must be convicted by the court. Third, the convict must be sentenced to imprisonment for a term not exceeding 3 years. Fourth, the convict must express his intent to present appeal before the appellate court. Fifth, the convict must be on bail on the day of the judgment. And lastly, there should be a right of appeal. In Anil Ari versus State of West Bengal, it was reiterated that there is a distinction between bail and suspension of sentence. One of the essential ingredients of section 389 is the requirement for the appellate court to record reasons in writing for ordering suspension of execution of the sentence or order appeal against. And if he is in confinement, the court can direct that he be released on bail or on his own bond. The requirement of recording reasons in writing clearly indicates that there has to be a careful consideration of the relevant aspects, and the order directing suspension of sentence and grant of bail should not be passed as a matter of routine. Section 390, arrest of accused in appeal against acquittal. Now, section 390 provides that when an appeal is being presented under section 378, the High Court may issue a warrant directing that the accused be arrested and brought before it or any subordinate court, and the court before which he is brought may commit him to prison pending the disposal of the appeal or admit him to bail. Section 391 provides where the appellate court may take further evidence or direct to be taken. Subsection 1, in dealing with any appeal under this chapter, the appellate court, if it thinks additional evidence to be necessary, shall record its reasons and may either take such evidence itself or direct it to be taken by a magistrate, or when the appellate court is a high court, by a court of session or a magistrate. Subsection 2, where the additional evidence is taken by the court of session or the magistrate, it or he shall certify such evidence to the appellate court, and such court shall thereupon proceed to dispose of the appeal. Subsection 3,
The accused or his pleader shall have the right to be present when the additional evidence is taken. And subsection 4, the taking of evidence under this section shall be subject to the provisions of chapter 23 as if it were an inquiry. Section 391 of the code empowers the appellate court to take additional evidence. Taking additional evidence by the appellate court is a discretionary power and it should not be exercised to fill up the gap or lacuna in the prosecution evidence. Section 392, procedure where judges of court of appeal are equally divided. Now, when an appeal under this chapter is heard by a high court before a bench of judges and they are divided in opinion, the appeal with their opinion shall be laid before another judge of that court, and that judge, after such hearing as he thinks fit, shall deliver his opinion, and the judgment or order shall follow that opinion. Added that if one of the judges constituting the bench or where the appeal is laid before another judge under this section, that judges so requires, the appeal shall be heard and decided by a larger bench of judges. Section 393, finality of judgments and orders on appeal. The judgments and order passed by an appellate court upon an appeal shall be final, except in the cases provided for in section 377, 378, subsection 4 of section 384 or chapter 30. That notwithstanding the final disposal of an appeal against conviction in any case, the appellate court may hear and dispose of on the merits a) an appeal against acquittal under section 378 arising out of the same case, or an appeal for the enhancement of sentence under section 377 arising out of the same case. Abatement of appeal, section 394. Every appeal against conviction abates on the death of the accused, except on an appeal from a sentence of fine. A sentence of fine is excepted from the rule of abatement of appeal because the fine constitutes a liability on the estate of the deceased. An appeal from a composite order of sentence of imprisonment and a fine is ordinarily directed against both the substantive imprisonment and the fine. But such an appeal does not for that reason cease to be an appeal from a sentence of fine within the meaning of section 494. All that is necessary is that a sentence of fine should have been imposed on the accused and appeal preferred by him should involve the consideration of the validity of that sentence. This section does not apply to an appeal to Supreme Court under Article 136 of the Constitution, but in the interest of uniformity, it is necessary that the rule of abatement should be the same in criminal appeals. Proviso to Section 394 enables any of the near relatives to obtain leave to continue the appeal. Explanation to Section 394 provides that the near relative means a parent, spouse, lineal descendant, brother or sister. Proviso is made to cover exceptional cases. In the case of S.V. Kameshwar Rao versus State, Kurnool District, Andhra Pradesh, the application by the legal representative of one of the accused in a criminal trial seeking leave to continue the appeal was made nearly after 10 years, and no explanation or sufficient cause was given for condonation of such undue and inordinate delay of 10 years. Held the application was liable to be dismissed. From a co-joint reading of Section 2 of Supreme Court, Enlargement of Criminal Appellate Jurisdiction Act 1970, Article 134, Clause 1, Article 134A of the Constitution and the Code of Criminal Procedure is, firstly, under sub-clause A of Article 134, Clause 1, an appeal lies as of right to the Supreme Court in cases where the High Court has reversed an order of acquittal of an accused person and sentenced him to death. Secondly, under subclause B of Article 134, Clause 1, an appeal lies as of right to the Supreme Court in a case where the High Court has withdrawn the case for trial before itself from any court subordinate to it and sentenced him to death. Thirdly, under Section 2 Clause A or 2 Clause B of Act 1970, an appeal lies as of right to the Supreme Court in a case where the High Court has reversed an order of acquittal of an accused and sentenced him to imprisonment for life or imprisonment for a term less than 10 years. Fourthly, under Section 379 of the Code, an appeal lies as of right to the Supreme Court in cases where the High Court has on appeal reversed an order of acquittal of an accused person and convicted and sentenced him either to death or to imprisonment for life or imprisonment for a term of 10 years or more. And lastly, in cases not covered by Article 134, Clause 1, Subclause A or B or Section 2 Clause A or B of the Act of 1970 or by Section 379 of the Code, an appeal will lie only either on a certificate granted by the High Court under Article 134 Clause 1 Subclause C or by the grant or special leave by the Supreme Court under Article 136 of the Constitution.
Thank you. Have a nice day. And for your questions and observations, you can write to me at my email ID. That is gautamgupta@mpdnlu.ac.in.